this is my friend Jeff, and he is a self-preservation one.
I am.
And so he's going to help us understand a little bit more about this particular subtype today. Yes, I know you will. So Jeff, tell us a little bit about how you see the self-preservation one in specific patterns playing out for you.
So first thing I should point out is that being a self-pres one does not mean that we're all like Felix Unger or that we keep everything. A self-pres one, being that, doesn't mean you're obsessively clean or orderly in every aspect of life, at least how that is to me. But there are things in my life about which, many things in my life, about which I'm really particular, and that those things tend to be things about me, the things that I'm concerned with in my own personal development. So I, as self-pres ones go, I can tell you that there's a certain divide. I will certainly appreciate and tolerate the circumstances that lead other people to do particular things. And in my heart, I can see why they would do that and understand and still not view it as something that I could do or that I would tolerate in myself.
Right.
So that's a big one. And then the other thing that I would say is that being a self-pres one is really just about vigilance at a fundamental level, that it's, vigilance has a certain aspect of anxiety to it, but it's different than anxiety, right? Because it's not paranoia or anything like that. I'm not afraid of everything all the time, but of those things that I've identified as particular threats or particular points that need to be addressed, I'm very vigilant about that. And there's always a part of my mind that is addressed with keeping those things in line or avoiding chaos in those particular areas.
It is said that the self-preservation one is the most anxious of the three ones. They worry a little bit more. And that makes sense that you say it's like a kind of vigilance, like making sure what everything is going right or all the details are covered. And maybe can you give us an example of what that might look like?
Sure. And I should give you some background, and this may sound familiar to any self-pres ones out there. So I had OCD obsessive compulsive disorder as a kid. And a lot of it had to do with my schoolwork or keeping things, and it really motivated me to be kind of perfectionistic in those particular areas, you know what I mean? So there's a certain climate of that goes on in terms of vigilance. From a self-pres one perspective, the most important thing, especially early on, is to try to be free of blame. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, the goal is to not be in a position where what I could have done or said would have averted something negative for myself or someone else. Right. So we're trying as hard as we can to make it not to be perfect for our own purposes, but to do whatever we could so that if something bad does happen, at least we have the comfort of knowing that we did all we could or we tried as hard as we could to avoid this outcome. Right. There's some things you can't avoid, but being free of blame is really what it's all about, at least at a kind of an immature level. And then that idea, I guess, would develop as the complex develops to be more of a flexible idea, but still grounded in that idea as being the goal of the vigilance, really.
Mm-hmm. So like trying not to make any mistakes, not to do anything wrong.
Right. And also to help other people to do this too, right? Because there's so much wisdom in the world that is about doing the small things before they become problems to avoid them becoming problems, or how small aspects of life or how our habits mold our character, in each one of those little different things. Each of those is a discussion of vigilance, right? Mm-hmm. Each of those is a matter of personal vigilance. And so the degree to which we take on that challenge for ourselves and to the extent we can be helpful to help other people, it's sort of a noble calling. And I know that it is a complex, but that's the heart of it, I would say.
Right. It's interesting.
I'm an attorney, so I went into a job that helps me, keep these skills sharp, right? It's sort of
Yes. I bet. So vigilance is also a little bit of a type 6 word. But I get the feeling, the way you're talking, that what you're talking about, there's kind of a moral element in
Definitely.
It. And so can you say how that fits in?
Mm-hmm. So I do not, like, I personally, I've done daredevil things. I've bungee jumped in a lot of different things. I'm like one of those people that will jump off something high into the water or things like that. So, and I will also take risks, you know, in my interpersonal life or personally where I might look foolish or whatnot. So you would not really imagine a six doing that, right? Mm-hmm. Because that's different than vigilance. Vigilance is kind of applied anxiety.
It's almost proactive anxiety.
Exactly. It's applied anxiety. There's not enough of it to go around. You can't worry about everything. You have to choose what to worry about. So the things to worry about first would be one's own personal moral standing and development, right? Mm-hmm. We all start there, mm-hmm. you know, to the extent we answer to our maker or otherwise return to the source, you know, that's job one. Mm-hmm. Then after that, it's our own sphere of influence, right? Mm-hmm. To worry about what our impact is in the immediate world. Mm-hmm. And then after that, it would be vigilance as to those larger world things that really are of that kind of greater magnitude or direct impact, right? So it doesn't help to worry about all the things that could go wrong. So you have to do a little worrying triage. And a moral structure is a good basis for doing, you know, vigilance triage.
Oh, yeah. So the moral structure is a little bit like, it gives you a guide in terms of knowing what to be vigilant about, you know, what the mistakes and the doing things wrong would be all about. And that seems like that's really the focus.
Don't get me wrong, though. It's a habit of mind. There's a lot of fretting. Maybe not as much fretting as a six would, but self-pres one is up there. If you want to, you know, if you want to compare who worries about what, you know.
Yes.
It's and of a course, hard habit to break.
And of course, I think there's a difference between being self-critical and self-doubting. You know, I think self-preservation ones are very self-critical. And would you say you're very self-critical?
Self-critical, not self-doubting.
Right.
Yes. I'm definitely self-critical. Oh, yes. Yes. Oh, yes. Yes. But I don't really doubt my ability. I hope for a good outcome, and sometimes that isn't ability based, but I have a really good assessment of my ability. As I would tell my wife, except with very few exceptions in my entire academic career through law school, I could walk out of every single test knowing how I did.
Wow. Wow.
I was almost always invariably right.
Wow. That's great.
So that's a matter of vigilance and keeping a good estimate of yourself and having a critical voice that's like doing the overall thing. I don't really know exactly how I did, but on the overall with all the data set, you know, I can
go
right in.
It's almost like the inner critic is functioning to say how well you did on that test. And if you did really well, it's telling you, wow, I think you did well on that. There's like almost like an accurate evaluation going on all the time.
True. Not only accurate evaluation, which one would surmise from the self-pres one perspective, but another thing that I do have to make clear is that the critical function in the self-pres one is really well developed, right? Like it takes over, and it can be very intrusive, but it's definitely something that we carry with us all the time and that functions kind of all the time. Mm-hmm. But, and though one could imagine it as being like going to the whip all the time, wham, 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 wham. And there are moments where it's like that. It is definitely not like that all the time. And a part of it is very positive, right? Like it's like having a coach that knows you better than anybody else could know you, knows all the things you think about, good, bad, and indifferent, and wants to encourage the best you. So that also is when you make a good play or you do something right or it works out, there's a feeling of fulfillment, like the critic gives you a pat on the back. And they're few and far between, but that's a very real aspect of this part. Yeah. It really is.
Yeah, you know? That's great.
Like self-pres ones are coachable, I like to think. We're coachable because we're coaching ourselves all the time.
Yes, that's beautifully put. So can you tell us a little bit about what your experience of anger has been like, maybe even over time, like putting a lid on it, if it, you know, reaction formation, which is, of course, you know.
Oh, good. Okay. So yeah. We self-pres ones are all about reaction formation, right? So, so one aspect of anger is I have an ability to see the good side of something, like invariably. Out in the world, you know, I'm able to accept someone, even something that's pretty crappy, and kind of, yeah, have a reaction to it, which is, you know, it doesn't feel inauthentic to me, does not feel inauthentic to me at all, and is really, it's almost like the habit of trying to keep a positive attitude in certain respects, kind of, you know, influences me to have this perception. So reaction formation, people can think it's a really strange phenomenon, because I can tell you from the internal perspective, it feels like my actual feeling about this.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. You're not aware. It's unconscious that you may be angry. You're just conscious of really genuinely maybe wanting to say something positive or express the opposite feeling, wanting to help, being helpful or kind or warm. And that feels really authentic. I think that's an important thing to say. And in a way, I think it probably is. It's just the flip side. And you're just sort of going unconscious to the angry part.
Right. It channels almost like it in a positive direction, right? Like being zealous about the solution to their problem is an easier thing than judging them for the source of their problem, right?
Oh, wow. Yes.
You know what I mean? Like yes. That's a better way to channel our energy about this thing, right? Like, but for myself, there's not that much reaction formation.
You mean you're angry at yourself more.
Right. And this is the thing too, is two other aspects about at least self-pres one anger, is that like most ones I'm imagining, it has a deep core of resentment, right? Mm-hmm. Like it's resentment because of how many things unnecessarily go so badly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that makes me sad. But at the same time, if I click on over, it makes me really resentful of people that just go through things, you know, just knocking stuff over.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Sometimes maliciously. And you see it on TV every day. If you want to see good examples of people with no internal vigilance for their moral character, you can see it everywhere, and the results of it everywhere. People get shot. People get left. People get abandoned. People get like all of these different things. Like, hey, I couldn't be bothered to think about that. I had other problems. And to those of us who are focused on this lift, which we've hoped that everyone will engage in.
Right.
People not engaged in that lift at all.
Right.
Causing trouble for my people.
Right. I remember I remember you described it once in terms of a social compact.
Yes.
You know, like ones believe in a social compact. Like there are kind of rules. If we all kind of follow the rules of good behavior, of obeying laws, let's say, then everything goes well. And working 24/7 to support doing things well. And, you know, and so when you see people kind of going against that, you know, like littering is a good example, right? If you see someone littering, it's like if people just made more of an effort to put things in a trash can, then everything would be clean for all of us. But because some people, it's like for whatever reason, they don't do But I can see how that, I mean, I'm a two and I have one right next door. That generates resentment in me too. And so I can see exactly what you're saying. When people aren't engaged in the lift, the work that it actually takes to be a good citizen almost.
Yes. And here's the thing though. And here's some reaction formation for us, which is I watched this old show and it showed people littering. Like people used to litter, you know what I mean? Like throw stuff out the thing. And like that used to be a consciousness that of course would drive us crazy. And now we know that that's not right. So what I'm going to say is like the arc of history is bending toward better citizenship. Mm-hmm. It may be a long and difficult arc, but over the course of time, it's bending in that direction. And I don't know if that's reaction formation or a cop-out, but it gives me hope even as there are more things around. Cyberbullying, cyberbullying. Like, anyway, you know, there are always more challenges, but I believe in humanity. One more thing I do want to add about the anger, and I know this in myself, is that it is deep and it can be explosive. And sometimes when I've been angry in my life, I've been very, very, very angry. Mm-hmm. So that when that anger radiates out, it scares other people. Scares other people, right? Mm-hmm. And to a certain extent, it's come to scare me, or it always did, in the sense that I know that I can't ever go full Nova.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I've seen where little past half Nova, I've seen the look in people's faces when I go little past half Nova.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's important to know both the magnitude of that fear and that we are vigilant for a reason.
Yes, yes.
Don't want a self-present one to really lose it. Like, you don't want a nine to really lose it, right? The result of that repression is a really, you know, a very compact energy in that way.
Right, right, right. And I know how sensitive you are to having a negative impact on others. You know,
it's
part of being a good person is really being concerned about that. And self-pres ones are such good people, and they strive for that so much in exactly the ways you're saying. But I also think, you know, you're human, and you know, you deserve to be able to feel your anger too. You know.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, don't want to go to jail. I mean, you know, to put a fine point on it.
Right, right, right. But hopefully the growth path is about integrating it, you know, like not getting to the point, you know, being able to, say, express resentment for it.
Exactly,
And people, ways people can hear, and so it doesn't have to get to the full
Nova. It doesn't have to. But I'm just saying, for self-pres ones that aren't engaged in this work, that can let this thing boil over and have one of those days where everybody pushes the wrong button, you know, it's not impossible to despite all of our moral, you know, centering that we try to do.
Yes, yes, I love the way you put that. Yes, exactly. Right, right. But again, then it's also another reminder to us of why you tend to hold yourself back, and that's part of the self-criticism, you know, is you got to hold back that anger, you don't want to have a negative effect.
Nobody likes it. Nobody likes it.
Yeah.
And also, you know, sometimes when it comes out, it's very cutting. Or sometimes when I'm holding it in, it leaks out the side. So I think I'm being totally cool. And from other perspective, even though I'm not saying anything or doing anything overtly, you know, energetically, it's like I'm incandescent. People are like, you know, because it's just, it's very radiating. When I'm, you know, when I get on my righteous thing, either toward myself or someone else, or I really feel hard done by, it's, you know, I'm not having it. And it's whether I'm expressing it or not, it's being expressed.
And I have to say, I've known you for a long time, and I actually appreciate the way some of your anger gets channeled into a kind of standing up for what's right in the world, and sort of expressing political opinions in ways that might influence people in positive ways. So I really appreciate that about you.